Dr. Erin Connealy, thank you so much for joining us today.
Well, thank you for having me. It's great to be here.
You are the founder and the director of the Center for New Medicine.
Yes, Center for New Medicine, and we have the Cancer Center for Healing, and we have the Addiction Center for Healing,
and that's all
in Irvine, California.
In the same location.
In the same location.
And tell me a little bit about your practice. I'm curious, because we're talking before the show about your practice and your beginnings and all of that. Tell me more about your practice now.
Well, we are conventionally trained medical professionals that combine the best of conventional Western medicine.
Okay.
And combining it with complementary alternative medicine. So that could be lifestyle treatments, herbs, nutrition, doing very unique nutritional testing, maybe stool testing, maybe saliva testing. I always use the analogy of the cell phone 30 years ago. Mm-hmm. What did it do? Basically, you could call in and call out, and that was kind of it.
Uh-huh.
But now you can navigate a million functions. So medicine has also developed the same way. What we did 30 years ago and what we're able to do now is absolutely amazing.
Now, is that the case in conventional medicine, do you think?
Well, conventional medicine, I believe, has kind of stayed where they've been for a long time. I mean, let's just talk about cancer.
Yeah.
For example, we basically do surgery, chemo, and radiation, and that's basically the treatment protocol for the patients.
And the chemo, from what I understand, has been pretty much the same, right? They're still using chemo that's 30 years old. Not itself 30 years old, but the concoctions, right?
A lot of it is very old. Nixon declared war on cancer in 1970. Their survival rate is about the same, about 2.5%. And so,
wow.
Yes, and so, but more people are getting cancer. But the survival rate is the same.
The same percentage.
Yes. And so cancer is about 1 in 2 men and about 1 in 41% of females.
Wow.
So it's exponentially, but not only cancer, all diseases across the board in all ages are increasing.
And you're seeing that in your practice.
Yes. I see young people. I used to say that people had a warranty until they're 40.
Uh-huh.
And then, but now I can't say that because we're seeing things. If you just look at children today, there's autism, ADD, asthma, autoimmune illnesses, other learning disabilities in children that, okay.
Just weren't there.
They just weren't there 30, 40 years ago.
It's crazy, right?
Right. And so we all should be saying, whoa, what is going on?
Mm-hmm.
Let's take a stance. Let's reflect on what has changed in the last 40 years.
Do you think, I asked my doctor this when I was, before I knew any of this stuff in the late 90s, before I knew anything about natural health, I asked my doctor and I was just so curious because my mom had just been diagnosed in 95 with cancer, and that's how we were talking before, how I got into this. And around 99 or so, I asked my doctor, I was in there for some visit, and I asked him, why do you think so many people are getting cancer these days? You know, my mom was just diagnosed. It seems like every person that I run across is diagnosed with cancer. And the only thing that he could say was, well, I think that we're just getting better at detecting it. But other than that, I don't know why.
But no, we're not.
And I just thought, wow, that's interesting. I mean, how come he doesn't know?
Yeah. Well, first of all, Nature published, I believe, May 2016, that we know why we have cancer. And that's because of lifestyle and environment.
Mm-hmm.
And so, but doctors don't really examine the lifestyle of a patient.
Yeah.
And they don't examine their environment of the patient.
Let alone their mindset and their stress.
Well, that's
level.
Lifestyle.
Yeah.
You know, that's everything. So and then the environment could be, okay, are they miserably married? Do they have a child that's very sick for a long time? Do they have ill parents, et cetera, right? Mm-hmm. That's their environment.
So what was that? You said that was Nature? Was it a magazine?
Nature magazine.
Magazine.
Uh-huh.
And they published that. What year was that?
That was just last year.
Oh my gosh.
Like May of 2016.
And they said that the majority.
So 90 90%+ of cancers are lifestyle and environment.
But they want you to think it's the genes, though. It's the genes that are doing it.
Right, but genes only only account for about 5% of cancers.
5%.
And we've known that for a very, very long time. Mm-hmm. And I always tell people genetics is not destiny.
And 5%, and even that 5% is not necessarily a death sentence, right? Because people like the work of Dr. Bruce Lipton, and you know, you can go above the genes. And Dr. Cruz was on our show recently, and he was talking about the mitochondria's effect on the genetic expression and things like that. And so when people think, oh, my mom had breast cancer and I've got the BRCA1 gene, I better do a preemptive, what's that procedure called? A preemptive when they remove the breast?
You mean a preventive mastectomy.
Yeah, mastectomy. Yeah. I mean, that's going on now. And
right.
It's all based on people's idea that the gene is the issue.
Right, exactly. It's and crazy. So unfortunately, what triggers genes is how you think, how you eat, and the environmental toxins mm-hmm. around you. And so unfortunately, when doctors see patients today, they don't do that kind of workup. And this science is all there now.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yeah.
The science is all there, but the doctors aren't, they're not utilizing. For example, how can you possibly fix a patient when you don't even know if they have the nutritional requirements for their mitochondria to even work?
Wow.
So you wouldn't be doing surgery on someone, you wouldn't be doing chemo, radiation on anyone until the foundation of that patient is fixed. Let's just take cosmetic surgery. You wouldn't do cosmetic surgery on a patient unless they were well. That's why they do what they call a pre-op visit, mm-hmm. right? Because you want to make sure that the patient is in optimal state in order to endure surgery. Just like you would a oncology patient, or they're going to do chemotherapy. If you look at the first thing you learn are the side effects of chemotherapy
right.
for the patient can be anything from cardiovascular, renal, cerebral, you know, immunological, and death, you know, as a consequence. So you would want to make sure that that patient is beautifully balanced in order to endure any treatments.
So why is it then, is there the breakdown in the traditional medical community with what you just said? So whenever you go into surgery, there's a pre-op, like you said, and they're going to make sure that you're physically strong enough to be able to get through the surgery. Why do you think they don't do that with chemo? Is it purely profit, or is there just an oversight? Because or do they they don't do much, do they, in terms of pre-op for chemo?
No, because right. No, when I see patients, the doctor hasn't even checked a vitamin D level. They haven't checked C-reactive protein, which is a marker for inflammation. They don't even check your blood sugar level. Nothing. And they do a chemistry, which checks your electrolytes, kidney and liver.
That's
it. And a CBC that checks your hemoglobin and white count. But other than that, that's about it. But they don't check thyroid function, blood sugar, inflammation, D, all the other parameters that every lab does. So if every lab does them, there must be a purpose, correct?
Right, you would think.
And
right?
So I remember recently, about a month ago, I had a patient from Minnesota, and she has lung cancer. And she'd already done chemo and radiation, which almost killed her. And so they said, okay, you can't do any more because it's so detrimental. She was only like 43, 44 years old.
Gosh. Did she smoke at all?
Yes, she did.
Okay.
And so not to say that everybody has lung cancer, because a lot of people have lung cancer today because of pollution.
Right, right.
Okay. So... but anyway, her mother was a full-blown diabetic.
Oh, wow.
And so I said, well, have they checked you for diabetes? Well, sure enough, she was diabetic and they'd already been treating her. Well, that I would think that would be one of the first things that a primary care practitioner would have checked.
Yeah, you would think, right?
Yes. So, well, first of all, you would have checked it even if there wasn't a family history, because diabetes is about, pre-diabetes and diabetes is 70-80% of the population. So in this day and time, I mean, that's what the literature says. It's not like, so I'm reading what the trends are to make sure I'm taking the best care of the patient.
Wow, that's so crazy to me that they don't test all of this stuff.
And, right, it's a simple blood test, and it's not esoteric. These are not esoteric tests. These are routine. This is routine testing.
So I was reading something recently. I think it's like, 26 or 21,000 people a day, I think this worldwide, either get diagnosed or die from cancer.
Yeah, in the United States, it's 1,600 people die a day of cancer.
1,600 people die per day.
Per day. Now, okay. And it's not on the news. It's not in Wall Street Journal. It's not in a magazine. And it's not on the news on a regular basis. Mm-hmm. Something's not right. Yeah. When you hear about... Okay, we hear about the Fort Lauderdale shooting and the other shooting. And yes, those are notable and newsworthy. But 1,600 people dying a day, and we're not saying, whoa, we have a crisis. Something's wrong. What are we going to do to save our own humanity?
Well, I guess it would make sense that they don't, because, you know, we have this whole war on cancer, like you said, Nixon said in 71. And so you have to keep this idea that we're innovating and we're making progress and making great leaps and bounds and things like that. So if you report 1,600 people a day, I mean, the other issue with that too is that they're spread out all throughout the nation. And so, but still, like you said, if you had something that was some disaster that was, you know, killing 1,600 people a day, every single day, 365 days a year, it's just picking off your population left and right. You would think that they would report that, but I mean, I guess it makes sense that they don't, but that's just sad.
Yeah, it's just very, very sad, because we're all here for one reason, to help one another and to help our community survive and thrive.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I mean, you see that many people, like you said, it's one out of two men and one out of three women. And even if you aren't someone who is specifically diagnosed with cancer, you know someone who has, your mom or dad has, your brother, sister, or friend.
Correct.
I mean, we all know probably, I mean, half a dozen people that have been either affected directly or indirectly by cancer.
That's correct. Everyone has. Crazy. Now in this day and time.
Yeah, it's just, it's absolutely nuts. And your book, The Cancer Revolution, just came out. Is that right?
Well, it's available on Amazon right now, and it's coming, official launch is January 20th.
Okay. So it was pre-launch. That's awesome.
Yes, exactly.
Oh, great. So how many of your patients that you see at the Center for New Medicine in Irvine, how many people do you see with cancer, do you think?
Well, that's a great question, because as I mentioned earlier, we have the Center for New Medicine, and then we have the Cancer Center for Healing, because a lot of those patients are there. On the Center for New Medicine side, we hardly ever see cancer, because
sense.
All of those patients and all of those people either want to practice prevention, or we educate them about prevention. Mm-hmm. So in our primary care setting, there's very few patients of ours that have cancer. Now on the Cancer Center for Healing, these are people that have been diagnosed and come once they've been diagnosed.
Okay.
And we know that the cure for cancer is prevention. So, but doctors are not practicing prevention. They're practicing reactive medicine. And so, and they maybe don't know about the prevention.
And they're applying acute medical care to chronic conditions, which is not a smart thing to do with chronic diseases.
Correct.
Do you have an issue at all? Because you still have the MD behind your name. Do you have any issue with any, gosh, I don't know, governmental anything with your practice and them, you know, having this hybrid approach that you have?
Well, no.
I hope not.
I'm counting on divine protection.
Yeah.
And because we're practicing minimally the standard of care and then some.
So the amount of standard of care you're able to practice is keeping you safe to some degree.
Yeah, because, and we're going beyond, and also the studies are out there, okay, that, like, for example, vitamin D, you need to be checking vitamin D levels, and there's thousands of studies on vitamin D on PubMed, right? Yeah. Okay. I
mean, go look at the studies.
Yeah. And then if you look at, like, for example, mitochondria, okay, mitochondria, the powerhouse engines of every cell in your body, okay, and they require these nutrients for them to work. Mm-hmm. So we're practicing what the literature is out there, okay?
And these things are in PubMed, and they're not in some esoteric spiritual magazine. They're in the actual scientific data.
Right. Well, just for nutrition, there's already 4,500 studies on how nutrition is important in cancer.
So,
but what doctor is telling, imparting that information and teaching patients?
Well, like what we were saying before the show, the doctors are unable to do that, unfortunately, because, I mean, what is the average time that they have? Is it 7 or is 10 or something?
Well, I don't know. I'm not sure how other practices run, but I know that they don't have the time. They don't have the time. They don't have the energy and the wherewithal, really, to take care of patients like we should. We just don't. I mean, medicine has changed. I've been practicing 30 years, and medicine's changed a lot.
Even just conventional.
There used to be care in medicine. Now it is just a, what do I want to say, very perfunctory.
Sort of rote.
Very, very, let's get them in, do the absolute what we need to be doing, and then move to the next person.
Yeah.
So.
The average doctor, like say oncologist, how many patients do you think they see a day? Is it a lot?
I don't know. I really don't know how
It's hard to say because your practice is so unconventional and so different.
Right. So I don't know how much, because cancer patients require lots of care. Now, what I find is that patients are coming in much more educated and empowered about information.
Are you finding that?
Yeah, which is fabulous. I mean, I think about 4 to 5 years ago, I always ask patients, so what's the first thing you've changed since you've had your diagnosis? And 100% of the time, every single patient, 100% of the time, they've changed their eating.
Really?
So that means deep down, subconsciously, people know that what they're doing is wrong, because
why would they change that?
Why would they change that? So that's the good news.
That's good. That's great.
Very, very good news. And people are becoming more and more and more knowledgeable about their options and about prevention, because like you said, everyone has a mother, father, brother, sister, cousin with cancer that they love, or that they've seen destroyed by chemotherapy, and they don't want that same life. So they say, you know what? I want to practice prevention.
Yeah.
So people are, and that's why I wrote the book, because we have to prevent the diagnosis of cancer, and we can.
The problem is that prevention isn't sexy, but it's so important. Oh my gosh.
No, it's not sexy. just like, let's take heart disease. What is the number one symptom in 50% of cases? Sudden death. Mm-hmm. So, but doctors are not practicing any kind of preventive strategies, which we have today. We have them today.
So what are some of the biggest lifestyle? Let's start with lifestyle maybe first, in terms of prevention, because they say that, you know, doctors, you know, if you use the cure word in convention and in alternative health, that's a bad thing. You can't use that word. But we know that the body is the ultimate can cure.
Correct.
And God, if people believe in God. But as in terms of lifestyle, what are some of the major things that you're saying people, besides the obvious ones like smoking and things like that? What are your first things you tell someone who's completely uneducated about this?
Well, if they're completely uneducated,
maybe we'll work up.
if they're completely uneducated, first of all, I have to take it very slowly. Because they don't have the knowledge. They think you just hit it with ammo.
And you can't go full bore.
Yeah. And
too much
so, but in today's time, you really do not, rarely do you see that now, which is good.
Yeah.
Rarely do you see someone who doesn't know anything. But I explain to all the patients that, okay, you're taking, you know, this, this, and this. But first and foremost, I want to restore health to your body.
Do you mean taking this, this, and this, meaning medication?
Like they're taking medicine, or they're taking, going to take chemo, or they're going to do surgery. And I educate them from the ground up.
Gosh, that's got to take a lot of your time.
It does, but life is sacrificial.
Yeah.
That's one thing I've learned. Whether you're a parent or a doctor, it's a sacrificial job. Mm-hmm. You have to sacrifice to do the right thing.
Mm-hmm. And these people matter. You never know if they yes. don't die from
and
cancer.
And if someone doesn't want to listen, then okay, then they it's a free world. You yeah. can go find another doctor who will just do the routine stuff. Mm-hmm. And so in our practice, that's not what we do. We try to educate every single person on how to live life according to the laws of Mother Nature. And I always tell them, look, I didn't write them. It's not my message. It's really the laws of Mother Nature that we preempted me.
Yeah.
So don't shoot the messenger.
Yeah, that's not my fault.
Right. And so we just know, we just all study the science. We all go to conferences for all the time and learn what's the latest, greatest. Because like what's at a conference will be in a textbook maybe in 5 years.
Oh, really?
Yes.
Yeah, it's super far behind.
Super far behind. Right. Yeah. And so, and why wouldn't we err on the side of caution anyway? Uh-huh. For example, sugar. Most doctors who see a patient with cancer, they go that diet doesn't matter. I would say all of them say that.
That's crazy.
Well, and even in Little Prevention magazine, they talk about eating correctly. Okay, there isn't a magazine that doesn't.
Yeah.
There isn't a publication that doesn't talk about eating well and eating correctly.
Okay. Even on the inside walls at the City of Hope, if you took the stairs, because we took the stairs, we didn't like to take the elevator.
Right.
It was citing studies, it was like graffiti on the walls talking about antioxidants and blueberries and all this stuff.
Right. But the doctors do not tell the patients that.
No.
but everyone knows that how you eat is how your cells are going to work, mm-hmm. period, end of story. And so that's the biochemistry of the body. Mm-hmm. Okay, that we all learned in medical school, that the biochemistry of the body, if you look at the Krebs cycle of energy is how when you eat proteins, fats, and carbohydrates, what biochemically it does with all of those micro and macronutrients. Mm-hmm. That's already been there. We've already learned that. Now, I personally and all the other doctors in my office, we all make sure that patients have all the micro and macronutrients so that each cell works for the patient,
okay.
right?
Yeah, gotta have that.
You gotta have that.
Yeah, it's important.
So regardless, let's say you eat Twinkies all day long, but at least we're gonna restore.
Yeah.
We're gonna counteract it with doing these three, four, five things, whatever it may be. And so, and that's available today to measure. And your insurance covers these tests too.
Wow. So they know sugar is directly tied to cancer.
Well, not only to cancer, sugar is directly tied to cancer, heart disease, and Alzheimer's. Three things I tell people you don't want to have. So, but when we're talking about cancer, the cancer cells have many more receptor sites for sugar than a normal cell. Mm-hmm. And that's what a PET scan is. Mm-hmm. A PET scan is measuring the sugar uptake value of that.
Any cells in the body.
Any cells. So that's how they find the cancer. So if cancer cells don't eat sugar, why do they do that PET scan?
So
that measures the sugar uptake value.
So wouldn't it be safe to say then by injecting the body with all that sugar for a PET scan, that would potentially cause cancer to grow because
you're
injecting
the
body with sugar?
But unfortunately, on some patients, you have to do the PET scan to see the extent of disease.
Okay.
So I do order PET scans.
Okay.
Because you have to, sometimes you don't know what you're dealing with
in a PET scan. The benefits outweigh the risks.
Yes. Uh-huh. So you'll know that. So you know, do you have this big a problem or just this little lump here that's 2 centimeters?
Okay.
Right.
Wow. So one of the first things you might tell people, well, I guess we're talking about lifestyle. So lifestyle obviously would include diet, but let's get to diet.
Well, that's not really, I tell people the most important thing that you can do, the single most important thing you can do, is to have positive thoughts.
I like that.
So I would say it begins and ends with that. So how you're directing your cells every day with your story you're telling yourself.
Okay.
That's really the biggest outcome. And when people get diagnosed with cancer, they're in fear and outrageous trepidation.
And stress.
And so they need to just go, okay, I have this. I'm going to acquire the information and knowledge, which we are living in the era of knowledge and information.
Right. Yeah,
I mean, it's
easier.
Overwhelming.
Yeah.
What?
It's almost too much.
Yeah, it's almost too much, right. And so you become what you think about most of the time.
Mm-hmm.
So you mentioned Bruce Lipton. There's many people now who are all saying that, whether there's Bruce Lipton or whether, but he beautifully puts all that information mm-hmm. in reality.
Yeah.
And, but, you know, lots of people are doing it. So
how about the idea, speaking of mindset, of someone owning a disease and owning a label? And I wonder about that too, because a lot of people will say, I have a friend of mine whose mom has, what does she have? Diabetes or, I forget. Oh, I'm sorry. No, rheumatoid arthritis. She mm-hmm. has rheumatoid arthritis, and she'll constantly refer to the disease as my RA. Like she's given it a nickname and she says it's mine. And I often wonder about the languaging patterns of saying, it would almost be more correct, wouldn't it, to say that my body is dealing with this right now? Because
I always tell people, first of all, change your language.
Yeah, yeah. So important, right?
And I would say the rheumatoid arthritis, that is temporary.
Yeah.
And then I am in the process of eradicating and healing my body completely.
Nice. Yeah. That's super empowering.
So we do that. I tell people, do not become your label. Don't focus on the diagnosis. Focus on the prognosis.
Okay.
Right?
So important.
So this is just a temporary part of my journey that I am challenged with, that I will become a testimony to my healing.
Wow. So when you are explaining something, a concept like that, because that's a deep, that's almost a spiritual concept. When you're talking to someone about that, what kind of reaction do they get? What kind of, because that's almost, it's so different from just mainstream thought.
Yes, but most patients, I think almost all of the patients like that though.
Do they?
Yes. Oh, yes.
Well, if they're
coming
to you,
because I'm not doom and gloom.
Yeah.
Okay, because I'm not allowed to give an expiration date like a lot of other doctors do. They go, oh, you have 3 months, you have 6 months, you have a year. Well, first of all, how do you know? Who made you the expiration date expert?
Right. Who
said
that?
I mean, like, no, none of us. Okay.
Right.
And you don't want to plant any kind of negative seeds in your patient, whether we're talking about cancer or anything else.
So important.
It's very, very important, because I'm the authority figure for these patients, and they're relying on my expertise, my direction. And I want to give them the most hope possible.
Mm-hmm. Even if it doesn't transpire, because maybe someone's destiny is to succumb to cancer. But even if they don't, it's so important, even if they do succumb to cancer, it's so important to have that mindset, I think.
Right.
You know?
It's
because
very
it gives
important
you the biggest
because
chance.
We're going to all make today great.
Yeah.
All we have is today.
Yeah.
Okay. So none of us know and have guaranteed that tomorrow's coming.
Right.
So let's just make today wonderful.
The best ever. Yeah.
Right.
So in terms of lifestyle, we know that toxicity plays a role in cancer, right?
Right. Well, we are living in a sea of toxins, whether it's in the water, food, air, it's ubiquitous.
Everywhere.
Okay. There's many a show that have talked about this. Mm-hmm. Okay. It's in the literature everywhere. I mean, Popular Science wrote an article on pharma water, all the pharmacy that's in water, not to mention all the chemicals, not to mention all. So you don't even have to pharma take water. Drugs. Now you just are taking them in the water supply. So,
Wow
is correct. So we have to be aware of all these things, but unfortunately our information sources and media sources are not educating the masses on what's going on in their environment. I mean, like, why wouldn't we be just telling people, why does it take Michigan, the Flint, Michigan story and another story about, okay, water's not, you know, our water supply is not good. I mean, like, why does it take some outrageous disaster for us to change when we all, our main goal, whatever we do, is to help humanity be in the best place ever.
Right.
That's really what our goal should be. I don't care if you're a minister, a radio host, a car mechanic, that should be your platform.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And
everyone has their platform,
right? Everybody. And we should be making that knowledge available because it's there. So our food supply now, it's kind of funny. Non-GMOs is funny. I was watching television and Centrum now even has their vitamin is non-GMO.
Oh, really?
Yeah. So I thought, wow, this is interesting.
So that means it was GMO.
Even Centrum, which is basically a synthetic vitamin, is on the bandwagon with non-GMO. So,
wow.
So, you know, we have a job to inform people. That's our job, is to research and inform the people of what is correct. So toxins are everywhere in our air, like I said, in our air, our water, and our food. And every single patient, unfortunately, needs to detox. So the first way to detox is stop putting more chemicals in your body by getting a water purifier or buying purified water, whatever works for you.
Mm-hmm.
Eat foods that don't have chemicals. They're organic fruits and vegetables. All the stores.
You can get it.
It's available. Mm-hmm. Okay. It's available. And then exercise, for example, helps your body detoxify. So
is that because of the sweat?
Because of the sweat and the mobility of the lymphatic tissues and everything. So we can do a lot of things. And then, like we talked about before, and we'll stress that, is how we think, okay? How we think. So we need to think about everything that we're putting in our body is going to be wonderful and great and create a healing mechanism in our body. And so we can do little things. Little things make huge differences.
Mm-hmm. Especially over time, right?
Yes. Well, even not over time, even in a week or two, if you radically detox someone, they feel way better than and I know because I personally have done it. So I know that you can make drastic differences with small changes. I mean, just telling someone to do an Epsom salt baking soda clay bath, they feel tremendously better.
Yeah, those feel amazing.
So you know, just little things, and that's something you can do at home. That's not really that expensive, but is very, very, very beneficial.
And that's an easy detox thing to do. And,
right.
And plus, when you're doing it, it's like you're going to be taking a bath anyway, most people. So why not just add some extra things to it?
Right. Easy. Exactly. Yeah. So we have to detoxify our mind and our body. And one of the biggest, I don't know what the true answer is, and that's the invisible energy web around all of us.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the cell phones and the iPads and the computers and the cell towers and all the electrical around us.
Mm-hmm.
So the best thing to do is to connect with nature some form or fashion every single day to ground yourself.
Yeah.
But it is quite impactful what's going on. And I don't know, there are a few answers, but I'm not sure the solutions are that ideal for the person other than to, because you know, everybody's at a computer every day, everybody's in their electric car, everybody's So all of that impacts, because one thing people forget about is that we are an electrical being. Mm-hmm. And so that we are emanating photons, electrons, protons, neutrons in our body all the time. And so this energy that's around us, how does that affect us? But we it affects us. We know, because all you have to do, it's interesting. We did a thermography, which is a thermal image of someone's head before cell phone use, 1 minute, 5 minutes, an hour, hours after, and your brain's inflamed with cell phone use.
You did this at your clinic?
At my clinic.
Oh my gosh, because I've seen images floating around online of that. And I've never really seen someone actually, you know, talk to the person that actually did it.
So yeah, right. We did it because we have a thermography machine, and my daughter in eighth grade had to do a science experiment. So we did it on how electromagnetic fields affect a living substance. Wow. So I would say the most remarkable was the picture of someone's head on a thermographic image.
So these people were using a phone constantly. No, it's not.
We just take any random person.
Okay.
Okay. No cell phone use. Their head. Uh-huh. Picture of their head. Then after a minute, after 5 minutes, after using the cell phone for an hour, then no cell phone use, picture of their head, the inflammation was still there.
I wonder how long it was there for.
We didn't do more than 3 hours. So.
Afterwards, oh my gosh, that's crazy.
Yeah, that's crazy.
Crazy. So it stays somehow electrically charged.
It affects you. So no matter what.
Wow. Well, so. I feel good about the fact I've never owned a cell phone, never had one, have no plans on getting one. Although I find it's getting more and more difficult to exist without one, because I could have called you this morning and said, hey, we're, you know, exactly where we are and things, but it's challenging. It's so challenging. And that's just a new thing. The other day I was, I have one of those little EMF meters, you know, right. The tri-field things.
Mm-hmm. I have one too.
And I used it in our car, and it was a 4Runner car. This was a little while ago when we had that. And so it was not an electric car by any means. And as soon as you turn on the engine and you turn the dial of that thing, it just spikes.
Yeah, right. And you don't have to have an electric car to have EMFs, though.
It's crazy. Okay. I know. So
like your refrigerator, your toaster, yeah. The light switches, all like they all emanate mm-hmm. electrical fields.
All these lights and everything.
Uh-huh, yes.
Yeah. So the question is, I mean, that's a small area of life, but it
no, it's
pervades.
Not. It's, yeah, exactly. Yeah, it's large maybe amounts. Small, but it's emanating, because it's not only your cell phone, it's everybody else's cell phone that affects you. Wow. So we need to harmonize these electrical fields the best way possible.
So you're telling people to text more, to hold the phone away from
you. Yeah, right. All those little things. Yes. Use earpieces, and then connect with nature on mm-hmm. a regular basis.
How are you telling people to do that? Go out and hike, go barefoot?
Go out and hike. Sit in the grass, sit on a natural stone, connect with some kind of natural source.
The other day I had the thought that we had Dr. Cruz on, who I mentioned, and the ideas that he was sharing was very similar to what you're sharing, and it just struck me in some weird way that wouldn't it be so crazy if all of our diseases and disease processes, cancer, all these diseases that you're working with people on, if they were caused by just a lack of being connected to nature? It's the simplest thing.
Lack of connected to nature and one another.
Yeah.
Because before, long time ago, people walked outside, we went to libraries, nobody emailed each other, and people called each other, but people talked to each other. Mm-hmm. I always find it fascinating that my staff is sending me an email and I'm right here, and I'm so irritating because, like, why can't you just come up and tell me?
Right. Right here.
So I'm of course, I'm the old school, you know, people, there's younger people today that, right. But I'm of the old school, like, just come up and tell me, communicate with me regularly. And God forbid there's a connection. All right.
Yeah.
So a human connection, I mean, which we all need. We're actually starving from social isolation.
Mm-hmm. Caused by a lot of the digital.
Yeah, because whether you're Twittering or texting or anything, that is not real, real touch.
It's connection. Not real connection.
No, that is not connection.
Yeah. And we're never meant for that kind of interaction with each other.
No, the studies show that people everyone survives better in a social, physical connectedness.
And I often wonder too, sure you're familiar with Dunbar's number and the amount of social connection that we're actually able to maintain in our brain is somewhere around 150. And outside of that, you start becoming disassociated. You can't connect with people and can't keep up with everything. And in today's world, it's like that. And I wonder, you know, for most people, they might have 7,000 friends on Facebook or some weird number that's way beyond that. And I wonder if all of that information, some of it, albeit stressful too, you're learning of someone else's diagnosis, you know, a friend that you don't even know, just got diagnosed with cancer. So that's more bad news. And I'm weak because I wonder if all of this information too, on top of the lack of physical connection, is just playing some sort of role in our stress levels and ultimately our immune system. It seems like it has to be.
It has to be. Well, definitely in our immune system and definitely, yes, completely. There's no question. Well, I don't think we've really identified every single facet of what's going on because I tell people the synergistic combination of chemicals in our body, no one's able to decipher what that's actually doing in our body.
Because, there's no test for that, right?
Yeah, there's no, right. There's no, because it's like an infinitesimal situation.
It's impossible.
And so, and then how everyone is so unique as their fingerprint. So everyone's inside. Somebody can be exposed to 100 chemicals and it really not affect them that much. Whereas somebody else, it could be disastrous.
Mm-hmm.
So
yeah, it's challenging. It's challenging because everyone has their own different levels of ability to deal with stress. You know, you see that all the time. We have neighbors on one side, and then on the other side, we have neighbors that are my wife's grandparents, and he's 96 years old, and he eats cake and pie and.
Well, there are people that can drink a fifth of vodka every day and or smoke a peck of. I mean, there are people.
George Burns.
Like that. There are people, okay? It is not typical, but it is possible.
Possible, yeah.
So.
Talk a little bit about some of the therapies that you do at the Center for New Medicine. I'm curious about, we're talking before the show, of all the different things that you have going on there. Talk a little bit about some of those things.
Right. Well, first and foremost, what we do is when we first see a patient, we get their history and we find out everything they're taking. And then we do a very thorough blood work with nutritional testing. And we have every single patient see the nutritionist.
Okay.
Because even when I have a patient who thinks they're an expert on nutrition or something, when they meet with our nutritionist, they go, oh my goodness, you are right. She truly understands the science of food.
Yeah.
So, and people have to value something that they're doing 3 to 6 times a day, that they're doing it right. When you think about it.
What do you mean they have to value
you're eating, it? You're eating 3 to 6 times a day, depending on the person. Some people eat and whatever, snacks and everything.
Yeah.
Wouldn't you want to know what you're doing is good?
Okay, right.
Seven days a week, 24 hours a day, that's what you're doing. You're putting stuff in your body.
Yeah.
Wouldn't you want to know that it is ideal or optimal?
Yeah, you wouldn't want to be wondering.
Wondering. You want to know, like, okay, am I doing the right thing? Mm-hmm. And in one visit, you kind of know that or don't know that, right?
Right.
So that's where it starts. Now, all of our patients will need different things, but we have hyperbaric oxygen.
Oh, wow.
Because we know that oxygen's the first thing we need to live and survive, but cancer thrives in a low oxygen environment. If someone has a chronic infection, they need oxygen for anything to heal. So hyperbaric is effective for many, many, many different entities, but for cancer patients, in particular, oxygen is absolutely essential for healing.
Do you use oxygen on the majority of your cancer patients?
Some form of oxygen, yes.
Okay. Some people maybe can't.
Otto Warburg got the Nobel Prize that cancer thrives in a low anaerobic environment fermentation process. So it doesn't need oxygen. Okay.
So it lives primarily anaerobically.
Anaerobically. So if you give cells oxygen, everything survives and thrives, okay. Right?
Yeah.
So, and they just did a study that combining the ketogenic diet with hyperbaric, they had a much higher success rate. So a wow. lot of our patients will go on a ketogenic diet, which is basically the absence of sugar and carbs. You eat fat, you eat good fats, you eat moderate protein, and your carbohydrate intake is low.
Very, very low, right?
Yes, very low. Depending on the person, okay, and depending on this clinical situation, you can't do a one size fits all.
Right.
Okay. And you just cannot do that in humanity. There's too many variations, but...
And you work with blood in each person to tailor something
exactly,
for that.
Correct. Okay. So, but if someone has diabetes, for example, you obviously want to go as low carb as possible because we know that works.
Right.
So, not to mention the efficiency of the mitochondria is magnanimous if you eat a ketogenic diet.
Oh, really?
Yes.
Okay.
So,
wow, so that affects genetic expression as well.
Exactly. So if you want a very efficient way of eating, and I tell people it's the eating program for if you have epilepsy, any kind of neurodegenerative diseases, diabetes, and cancer. So we're finding that that is the best way to preserve and optimize cell functioning is to eat a ketogenic.
What does the keto have to do with heart disease? Do you know how it,
yes,
is it
ketogenic
good for them?
Too. You want to again sugar. If you give patients sugar, they form plaque. Sugar plays a very big role in heart disease.
But if you eat fat, it's going to clog your arteries.
About using the right kind of fats.
Yeah, no.
Correct?
Yeah.
It's all about using, like, do you use seeds and nuts and...
Avocados
and coconut oil.
Yeah.
Those kinds of fats. Because why do you even need fat? You need fat because the cell membrane of the trillions of cells in your body is made of fat. Mm-hmm. Your brain is, I think, 85% fat.
And that's its primary fuel.
Yeah.
Too, right?
So you want to make sure that you are preserving, again, the architectural structure of your body to take care of itself and function.
And what about nerve function, too? And
nerve function is a very big deal with fat.
Exactly. Yeah, I guess that's why the ketogenic diet is so good for... people with epilepsy and things like you said, right?
Right, correct.
Interesting. Mm-hmm. Okay, so...
Hyperbaric oxygen. We do lymphatic drainage with... We use a machine. We do it manually, and we use a machine called the light beam generator.
Oh, wow. I think I've heard of that.
Yeah. And then we have a bath called a nanovative bath, which pumps nano-sized oxygen through the bath water, and that you absorb it through your skin.
Wow.
Okay, and it's pretty amazing.
It's called nano bath.
Nano baths.
Uh-huh. Nano baths. Wow.
And it's new. It's from Japan, and we brought it here, but it works amazing. And I've done analysis of people's blood before and after,
it's
like they've done a purification when they do those baths.
That's what's so cool about you being in the practice you're in, because you get to have all these tools, but then you can also do the blood work, because a lot of people have these tools and they think that it's doing well, and it probably is, but you get to do the blood work right after and actually verify, like you did with the thermography.
Right.
That is so cool that you get to get data on these things.
Right. And then we use a PMF, pulsed electromagnetic fields. We know that when a cell is unhealthy, that they're resonating at a very low millivolts, right?
Okay.
And so when you have the patients lay on the pulsed electromagnetic field, or we have actual topical placement, individual placement on a body part, let's say it's a breast or a pancreas or somewhere
put it
else
right on top,
and you put it right directly on time, so on top, to targeted therapy. So
okay.
We do that also. Then we have all kinds of IVs. We do everything from IV vitamin C to sodium bicarb to chelation therapy, to IVs of lipoic acid,
wow.
IVs, I mean, all kinds of different IVs, curcumin. So if they're patients will have targeted treatment depending upon their particular condition.
Do you guys have, or do you do, I think I've heard of people doing DMSO vaccines.
DMSO.
Or not vaccines, but.
But we add DMSO to our IVs too.
IVs, that's right. So people can take that through an IV.
Right.
Wow. I've taken DMSO topically, but I never, sure. And some people drink it, but I've never.
Yeah. Yeah.
I don't know, it seems kind of.
Yeah, it'd be kind of, I don't know about drinking it, yeah. Even though, I've used it for a long, long time.
Yeah.
But a DMSO topically has been used for, 50, 60 years.
So you will put together a treatment program that includes these IVs and includes
all of these things. Yeah, depending on the patient and what they have and what they need. And obviously, everything we do is to energize and uplift and heal the body.
Okay.
So nothing that we do destroys the body, has a negative side effects, has potential harm.
Is there an issue? We were talking about this a little bit before we started recording. Is there an issue with people trying natural remedies as a last resort?
Is there an issue?
Well, if you were to take the same person, because you've been doing this for 30 years, so if you were able to maybe clone a person and say, this person went and got chemotherapy, radiation, stem cell transplant, or transplant surgery, and all these things, and that same person chose to do natural, because it seems like there's an issue. If someone comes to you after they've done all of those things, the body has been broken down quite a bit. And natural remedies can still work for somebody like that, which is amazing. So I often wonder if the person never broke their body down with those chemotherapy and radiation, would they have a much higher chance instead of coming to you as like, I'm on death's door kind of.
Right. Okay. Oh, yeah, it's always better to combine forces, right?
Okay. Right. Right.
So for example, if someone's just going to even have surgery to have a lumpectomy,
right,
it would be best to prepare that patient 2 weeks prior and to give them things, for example, modified citrus pectin, prevent metastasis. So all those things would be much better if the patient did it before
and
during and after,
yeah,
than not.
Than okay? Not doing that at all.
The outcome is significantly better. Mm-hmm. So,
and IPT is something that's sort of a modified version of what you're talking about too, right?
IPT, insulin potentiation therapy, yeah, with chemo, right. IPT has been around for over 50 years, okay? Yeah. So you're basically utilizing low-dose chemo, about 10%.
10% of what they would normally
give, but you use it with insulin. Insulin, you give the patient insulin first to bring the blood sugar down, and then to escort the chemo to the cancer cells, preserving the rest of the cells in the body so they're not damaging all the other cells.
So not only are you giving less chemo, but the chemo that is given is being redirected to where it actually needs to go and not breaking down organs and unassociated organs and things.
Right, exactly.
Interesting. What is that a pretty common practice, and how successful is that?
Well, it's common with integrative doctors, mm-hmm, all right? The individual doctor goes and learns. And
people having success with that?
They're having success. There will be a paper published. I don't know if it's published yet, but it will be pretty soon. There's an integrative oncologist out of Reno who is publishing his results, and he is saying that if you combine IPT chemo with a targeted plan with nutrients, et cetera, mm-hmm, that the 5-year survival rate is much, much higher.
Wow.
So, but I always tell people, you can't go by studies. Amgen, which is one of the largest pharmaceutical companies in the world, did a retrospective analysis of oncology studies. Mm-hmm. And found that 47 out of 53 couldn't be duplicated even after 50 times.
Oh my gosh, really?
So that means that oncology studies and double-blind randomized clinical trials,
they can't be duplicated.
They can't be duplicated. And so there's no one like as I said before, there's no one like you. Mm-hmm. So predicting what's going to happen is
almost impossible.
It's almost impossible. Okay. Wow. I know the science community doesn't want to hear that.
No.
But first of all, how people think, it's just like the book, The Placebo Effect.
Uh-huh. Right.
I mean, if you think something's going to work, that's what works. Even with antidepressants and a lot of drugs, the placebo effect is 50%.
Still, yeah.
So
it's, that's crazy, isn't it?
Yes, it's crazy. 50%. So like if you tell the patient, okay, you're going to die in 3 months, the patient should usually die in 3 months. Whereas if the patient says, hell no, I'm not going to die in 3 months. Yeah. I'm going to show this doctor that I'm living 5 years.
Yeah.
Well, guess what? He'll probably live 5 years.
Yeah.
Okay. So I know we want to do clinical studies and have the science and all that great stuff.
But it's too hard.
But the variables, okay. The variables, how someone sleeps, the water, do they drink water? Do they eat well? Do they have chronic stress? Have they had chronic stress? Do they have unresolved emotional conflict? Do they have vitamin D deficiency? Do they have high blood sugar? Do they have low adrenals? Do they have a low, I mean, it goes on and on and on and on and on.
Emotional stress, toxins.
Exactly. It just goes on and on. And so if you're not taking into account every single thing, it's like, okay,
how could you replicate that study?
Yeah. So it's like, for example, autism. Okay. No one's figuring out what the cause of autism. All we're talking about is treatment of autism, but no one's talking about prevention of autism. Mm-hmm. So, but no one's come up with, okay, this is a cure. There's not going to be a cure for autism because there's too many things to do with the human being.
Mm-hmm.
Just like for cancer, just like for heart disease, any complicated diagnosis is going to require a very, very multifaceted approach. Yeah. That's like saying, okay, I can make chocolate chip cookies with chocolate chips.
Yeah.
No, you can't. You need the other 9, 10, 12 ingredients. I'm sorry. That's just it.
That's the way it works.
That's the way it works.
Yeah.
So, well, the human body is very, very complicated. That's got trillions of cells. That's 12 zeros with 100,000 chemical reactions taking place per second for every cell. Okay, and you can't even imagine the science of all that.
And the amount of cells that die and get regrown every second is like in the billions or something.
Exactly. So, that's so crazy. And we don't live in a bubble. If you lived in a bubble and I controlled the water like you do in a goldfish, and you know, you probably have had goldfish before and they've all died because that water wasn't perfect, okay?
Right.
So it's very similar with the human being and human doing is that they don't live in a bubble. They are affected by what happened at work, what happened to their child, what happened to their parents, what's going to happen, what could have happened, what they heard on the news. I mean, we're all affected by 1,000 different inputs.
I mean, think about that study that you or that idea you were just sharing about how they weren't able to duplicate those studies even after 50 tries. I'm assuming that they were trying to duplicate it with the same people. But if they were trying to, even if they're trying to duplicate it with the same people, you have those people now have, it's like a snapshot in time. Those people now have different events going on in their life.
Right. And also,
even if it's the same person, they still got different stresses.
Exactly. And all different.
Yeah.
Everything.
And different outlooks and how they manage stress.
Right.
That's crazy.
Yeah.
That's crazy. So you do a lot of really cool things there. What other things do you do, treatments and things?
We use a device called the Undamed. Undamed is a German device that's been around in the United States for probably 13 years now.
How do you spell it?
O-N-D-A-M-E-D. Onda is for wave, okay?
Okay.
So basically, we know what the energy frequency of everything in your body. So you put the device around your neck and the practitioner feels your pulse and then it runs all the frequencies that we know exactly of the body and we detect which one is out of balance by the pulse going up.
Oh, wow.
And then we put the correct frequency to balance the body.
So it's going to detect, like, if you put one around my neck, it would detect what?
What? Like, maybe your adrenals are off, or maybe lung exchange is off, or maybe
liver,
your liver, stomach, on and on and on. It might be even emotional, too.
Okay, so it would tell you that.
It would tell me that, and then I can dial in the frequency they want to balance that situation.
So the machine can give a reading, but then also...
And do a treatment. Exactly.
Wow.
Well, yeah, because you're basically dialing in the radio station that you want, right? So you're dialing in the radio station for your body.
How cool is that?
Yeah.
How long have you had that?
Oh, 12 or 13 years.
And it's been around for...
It came from Germany.
Wow.
So
those Germans, man,
they are on top of it.
They've got some tools, don't
exactly.
they?
Exactly. And then let's see, the nutrition, the oxygen therapies, the PMF, and...
What about ozone?
Ozone IV and rectally. So why not? We have a doctor that just specializes in IV ozone. So where they take... It's another German machine.
Shocking, right?
Yeah. And basically, you take out the blood... ozonate it and put it back in and take more blood out. So you can oxygenate a fifth or a half of your blood in a session.
Wow. How long does that take?
About an hour.
Speaking of that, do you do ultraviolet blood irradiation?
Yeah,
as well?
we do, but that's been replaced with something called ultraviolet light RX.
Oh, really?
So this is a light with a certain amount of nanometer that goes in your vein and kills all the microorganisms, as well as oxygenates the system, as well as activates the immune system.
Golly.
So that's very new. Okay.
Wow, it's like a little playground you have over there for you.
I tell people we have Disneyland for medicine.
How do you yourself? I mean, sure,
I use all the
How fun is that?
Of course. I do something in my clinic every single day.
That's so cool.
Including the emotional work, including the oxygen, including everything, because you cannot be a good teacher and educate people if you don't all do it yourself. Plus, I've had my own health challenges. That's how I got into this. Is I was born in the 50s, and they used a drug called DES, diethylstilbestrol, that was designed to prevent the miscarriage, and I'm number 3 of 6 kids. And then my parents got a letter 16 years later stating that DES causes cancer and anatomical problems and hormonal problems, and that I needed to go to MD Anderson to get checked. MD Anderson is one of the largest, or the largest, medical center for cancer in the United States.
So you got a letter? Or your mom
My
did.
Parents
Your
did.
Parents did. And how old were you at that
16
time?
Years
16
years old.
Okay.
So that was a long, long time ago. So I started going to MD Anderson a long, long, long time ago.
Wow.
And so of course, your mess becomes your message.
Yeah.
And so my whole journey is for prevention. And plus, I did not have normal menstrual cycles. Mm-hmm. I couldn't have kids and... all kinds of different things. I mean, I have kids now, but through a pure act of miraculous nature, I have children.
Wow.
And so it's been a very, very challenging journey, but I would never be able to execute and implement what I know if I hadn't had the challenges I had.
So
it awakens you and enlightens you like no other.
So that experience, being notified at 16 and going forward from there, was directly involved with you going to medical school
and choosing the path. And also, you know, I've lived my whole... Luckily, I had mentors in my life, who... one gentleman who had cancer, survived osteosarcoma, which is a... usually 99.9% of the time fatal diagnosis. It's a bone and muscle cancer. It's not, it's, you know.
How long ago was this that he survived?
Well, he was diagnosed when he was 22. I met him when he was 50 after he had cured himself. So he was diagnosed at 22. They said, "We're going to amputate." And he said, "No, I'm not going to amputate my leg." And he spent the next 11 years, not months, 11 years, figuring out how to save his leg and cure himself of cancer. So I meet him at a conference at 50 years of age.
Wow, he did all this 22 years ago.
No, 22. No, he was...
Or 28 years
40 ago. Years ago.
Oh, 40. Okay.
Yeah, because I met him at 50 and he died at 68 or 69.
Oh, okay, okay.
So, and he'd already had it 28 years. He'd already survived 28 years by the time I met him.
Isn't that crazy?
Yeah, it was. He was a remarkable man and amazing story. And luckily, one of my mentors or I wouldn't be doing what I'm doing because to have this understanding of everything is pretty remarkable. Golly. Really remarkable.
So, his will and his desire to live. Yeah.
His will, yes.
And his mindset. And that must have been the biggest teacher for him.
Absolutely. And this guy was a renegade, tough guy, and I'm not taking no for an answer.
Wow.
And that's the way we all need to be, right?
Wow, that's so cool.
Yes,
Golly.
It is.
Wow. So you guys work with patients from around the world, I would imagine.
Yes. People come in from all over the world to get treatment because of what happens is people are seeking answers and they're looking around to see who else has, you know, another way of doing things. Mm. And so what I call functional integrative medical doctors, that's the wave of the future. Mm-hmm. All right. It's just that to learn all of this information you can't learn it in a weekend course.
Yeah.
It takes many, many, many conferences to learn what we need to learn.
And experience with the practice.
Right. And we are still learning. Okay. Yeah. I'm still learning. All right. So doctors, unfortunately, can't just go to a weekend course. I think they could go to a week course and go, oh, my goodness, I can't go back. And I've talked to many a doctor who used to practice. They were ER docs or some kind of doctor, vascular surgeons. I mean, all kinds of doctors who practiced the
standard of care,
whatever, conventional medicine, and then they learned all the new medicine, what I call the new allopathic medicine.
Because this new medicine model is constantly changing because people are able to do research more.
Well, medical knowledge is doubling every 2 years.
Yeah.
So we're
learning so much.
Yeah. Just like there's a new version of an iPhone, right? There's a new version of medicine coming out all the time. And we got to look for non-toxic, non-harmful ways to take care of people.
Have you heard of, speaking of that, there was a video going around recently of some research some scientists are doing where they're injecting through a needle. It's almost similar to cryotherapy.
Yeah,
where they're injecting the tumor cells with this nitrogen or something.
Yeah,
it's freezing.
Exactly. We do that. We recommend patients do that. I work with two different doctors that do that.
What is that practice actually called?
It's called cryosurgery, basically.
Is that right?
Yeah.
Is there any issue with that? Because you know how they talk about with cancer, if you do a biopsy, there's a tendency
tendency for it to spread.
For it to spread throughout the blood. Does that...
There are papers in the literature on that, okay?
But with the cryo...
Well,
do you think there's anything there?
I don't. I think it's too much in its infancy to know. Uh-huh. But you're going to be, when someone is stage one, there's already circulating tumor cells.
Yeah, I've heard you say that before.
So the cancer cells are already there. And so if something is a millimeter in size in your body, it's already releasing circulating tumor cells and stem cells. Okay.
Yeah.
So, you know, we have to, that's happening regardless. And I know, does the intro of something, I don't think it should stimulate, you know, the metastasis. Now, a biopsy is blind. If you just think about it in your head, a biopsy is blind and it's an injury. And a biopsy is an actually injury to the body, and an injury creates a weakness, and the weakness creates the possibility of cancer, right?
Spreading.
Because it's just what happens. So it's like someone will injure their breast and get cancer a year or so later. I've seen that.
Yeah, okay, I have a friend dealing with that right now.
Yeah, they bruised it or something, and I've seen that. You know,
an injury.
If you really listen to people's stories, you know, you will find so much information. I always like the story because it's fascinating.
It tells you everything.
Yeah, it tells me everything, and it's just fascinating. So I just think if a doctor goes in blindly, I know they say to patients all the time, oh, no, no, that's not cause. But no one absolutely knows. No one's in there with the microscope looking for what's going on with the
circuit. Looking at the cells,
the microscopically. No, we don't have that ability. Yeah. We don't have the technology. The doctor doesn't have the ability or technology.
So at best, he's guessing.
He's guessing. So, you know, we have to, again, err on the side of caution.
Right.
So even preparing for a biopsy is a good idea, correct?
Yeah,
think about
think,
it.
Yeah.
So, I mean, that's just my philosophy, and I think that makes logical sense.
Because you're actually going into the body when you do
right.
something like a biopsy.
Now, with the cryo, you're using an ultrasound-guided methodology to make sure the probe is going in, right?
To the exact spot.
So, of course, you know, with new science, things are, you know, we're always learning new things, right?
So what got you to write this book? Because a lot of your patients obviously are cancer patients, and you've been doing this for 30 years. Did you just finally get to the point where you thought, I have to write this book, Cancer Revolution? Or did you come across some new information? Or were you just seeing too many people with cancer that you thought finally just the straw that broke the camel's back?
Well, I think people need to have the information all in one book with the references, okay? And I think doctors and patients need like a handbook, a starting guide that kind of puts everything together, mm-hmm. whether it's the circulating tumor cell and how to do the blood test for the circulating tumor cell, to prevention, to what is the eating part, what's the mind part, what's the detox part, what's the nutrient part, all these things.
Because a lot of people just focus on the physical, the body.
I feel like I put it all together in one book. So like this is what I will give to every patient or every prospective patient, or let's say a doctor. Like let's just say you're a brand new doctor and you don't really know anything. This will start you out, mm-hmm. okay? And then you can go, oh, let me go read on this, and let me go read on that. Let me go read on Bruce Lipton, or what? Let me go read on ketogenic diet. Let me look on activity. You know, I mean, I talk about Qigong. I mean, everything in the book, okay?
Mm-hmm. I love Qigong. It's great.
So this is a broad stroke of everything that a patient and our doctor needs to know and have the working knowledge to take care of a patient or to take care of themselves.
Wow. Yeah, because it's all, like you said before, prevention.
Yeah,
it's so much information.
It's overwhelming, the information out there that I can't impart in a couple of visits what I really need to tell the patient.
Yeah.
So if the patient can little by little read the book, then they can come in and say, well, Dr. Connealy, shouldn't you check my blood sugar again? Shouldn't you check Dr. Connealy, my inflammation marker is high. Now I understand what that means.
And they'll start being their own physician.
Exactly, because I tell patients,
so important.
From the time you see me, it takes about a year to learn how to take care of yourself.
Yeah.
Meaning, not. I'm talking about a cancer patient.
Right, right.
Now, a patient who just want to come in and they want to get healthier, that shouldn't take a year.
Yeah.
But
still, coming off conventional knowledge and conventional wisdom, all of these ideas are so radical that it would take the average person a long time to sort of wrap their mind around all this stuff.
We have to start treating, we need to start teaching health from the day someone's born.
Agreed.
Because health is wealth. Health is not something you buy. Health is a process.
Something you earn.
And it's something you do every day.
Uh-huh.
Every day.
How you think,
how you sleep, the water you drink, what you eat. I mean, everything. That's something we just all do every day. And, you know, I tell people, if you don't spend money, time, and energy on your wellness, you're going to be spending it all on your illness.
At the end, right?
At the end.
Yeah.
And so let's not do that. Why wouldn't we restore the health of humanity? I tell people, if there's no health of humanity, there's no business, there's no politics, there's no
sports.
There's no nothing, right?
Yeah.
So wouldn't it just like be the greatest thing in the world if we just put health priority? It's like I tell ministers, I go, look, if you're not addressing health with your congregation, how can they listen to you? Right?
What do they say?
Well, I'm, you know, because they're up there on a podium, like
in front of people.
In front of people. Like, yeah. we're all here again to help one another survive and thrive. Mm-hmm. So no matter, I mean, like you in particular are doing health shows, mm-hmm. but everyone has that opportunity, health opportunity each and every day mm-hmm. to help someone be the best they can be.
Yeah. Yeah, and it's unfortunate too, because a lot of people, what they think is they don't pay any attention to their health. And then, like you said, some catastrophic diagnosis occurs, and then all of a sudden they have to change their life. And, you know, when you learn in a way that's progressive, it's so much easier. It's so much, it allows your mind to expand in a way that is progressive, so that you can take in more ideas when you're ready for them, instead of being bombarded with all of this information. Oh, I just got a diagnosis of stage 3 or stage 4 cancer.
Right.
And now I'm learning about energy medicine. What do I do? Do I do the ketogenic diet? But if you're constantly learning throughout your day and your life, it doesn't have to be your number one priority, because a lot of people are business people, or they're sports people, or they're educators, but it should be a part. It should definitely be a part, because prevention, if we can prevent these diseases, I don't know, what is cancer? Like, each cancer patient, aren't they worth something like hundreds of thousands of dollars?
Yeah.
It's a billion dollar industry.
Right. Yeah. It's crazy. It's a lot. I would say, well, depending on the complexity of the case, it could be, you know, $300 to $1 million, depending
per
on
patient.
Yeah, per patient, depending.
But then also you got to look at the cost of these people who should be out there contributing to society, making society better, but they can't because they're laid up with these diseases.
Well, not to mention the burden of the family, not to mention the burden of a business. Mm-hmm. I mean, businesses today, their healthcare costs are outrageous now.
That's insane.
So, you know, self-insured companies now are into prevention, because we're spending way too much money on illness and not on prevention.
Are companies becoming aware to the prevention
idea? Yeah, well,
idea?
Self-insured companies, see, because they pay for all the bills.
Yeah, so they have to.
So, of course, they're going to say, okay, employee, Joe, Cindy, Debbie, look, We are all paying our own bills, yeah. So you've got to do your part in preventing illness. So yeah. So they're very, very, very interested.
Yeah, I think we are waking up. I think we are waking up, and it's a good thing. And you're saying too, now that your patients are much more educated, and that's probably as a result of the internet. And so these are great things. It's great.
Right. Well, people are reading, they're watching this YouTube, or they're listening to there's lots of books too out there. There's a lot written out there. So even I tell people, even if it's only 50% true, there's invaluable information.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, yeah.
Like juicing. Okay. What's wrong with juicing?
Yeah.
Okay. Great idea. But just juicing every day, or buying, you know, now it's all available.
Yeah, you can buy it.
Any store. Every store has juice. Every single store has juicing available.
And you're seeing people, stars, walking around with green juices now.
Right,
and
exactly.
Becoming more in vogue.
Right. It has. Now it's totally, you know, the deal. So
one quick thing before we leave, because I know you have to go see patients. I've heard you talk about before, and I actually heard about this a few years back, but there was a cancer test where you could actually determine the type of chemotherapy and or natural remedies that would be specifically effective on one's particular cancer. Do you know what test that is?
Right. Well, there's a lab called RGCC, and they're located in Greece.
In Greece.
RGCC. And RGCC. And now, they're not the only lab, but it's the most comprehensive laboratory with its services.
Okay.
And so RGCC, they are about 12, 13 years old. They have the highest laboratory international certification in the world, which takes about 2 years to get.
Wow.
And that will check your circulating tumor, the circulating tumor cells.
Okay, nice.
It will check the natural things that work on the circulating tumor cells. Because what we need to alert our audience is that circulating tumor cells are not affected by surgery, chemo, and radiation, and you have remission and or cure when your circulating tumor cells are zero. That's what's in the oncology books as of today.
Wow, when the circulating tumor cells are zero.
That's how you know you have remission and or cure.
But now they're saying if we just remove the tumor, you're cured.
Well, that's what doctors say, but actually the books, which I did not write,
They are saying
that you have remission and or cure when your circulating tumor cells are zero.
Okay.
So the only thing that works on circulating tumor cells are natural substances like vitamin D, vitamin C, curcumin, genistein, resveratrol, etc. Right?
Okay.
So this test will tell me which is the most sensitive to what substances are the most sensitive to the circulating tumor cells in a particular body.
Wow.
It also will tell me what chemo is most favorable for that particular patient.
So if they want to do the chemo, they can...
Because you may have to do chemo, because chemo is to shrink tumor burden. So you have to shrink tumor burden because tumor burden is sending out lots of abnormal signals to the body. So you always want to get rid of tumor burden.
So you work with, or you can... prescribe these tests, or
we use those tests a lot every day.
That's great.
We order circulating tumor cells. We order sensitivity for chemo, the natural sensitivity, and everything. So, absolutely. So,
what about the Oncoblot test? And
Oncoblot. So that's prevention. So there's several ways to prevent cancer. One, ordering just regular blood tests, like doing a CRP, which is C-reactive protein, which is your marker for inflammation. Ordering D, ordering DHEA sulfate, which is a marker of your adrenal glands, ordering your thyroid, because like if you're low thyroid, you're higher risk for cancer. So just doing, and then you can just do tumor markers like CEA, ovarian CA125 for ovarian, breast tumor. You can order like an entire tumor marker panel just to see if the possibility anyone. That's what can be done on routine testing.
Like once a year?
Once a year. But more accurate testing would be a blood test called the cancer profile, which checks your quantitative HCG, checks your marker for low oxygen, PHI.
PHI,
which is the enzyme of anaerobic, meaning no oxygen environment.
Okay.
And cancer, remember, thrives in a low oxygen environment, right?
Okay.
So, and then it checks a liver on the same panel, checks your liver, adrenal, and thyroid, and CEA. CEA is a nonspecific marker.
Okay.
Then you have Oncoblot. Oncoblot checks the ENOX2 protein on cancer cells, and it's 95%+ accurate.
Wow.
And it will tell me what tissue type. Now, there is another test that's coming out with RGCC that will tell me also, that's coming out any day now, that will tell me what tissue type or the tissue of origin of a cancer.
Wow.
So, but even...
So that test's not even out yet.
No, not even out yet. And
wow.
then also, you can just check circulating tumor cells. You, for example, you could just come in and get... circulating tumor cells. Now, usually I don't use that as the initial screening. I will use it for a patient. Like, for example, I had these two sisters come in from Austin, Texas, who they had the BRCA, one of the BRCA genes.
Mm-hmm.
So they both did the Oncoblot. One tested for breast, one tested for ovarian. All their scans are completely normal. No scans were positive or in any form, but I always tell people from one cancer cell to tumor formation is 10 years. So there's lots of window of opportunity to prevent cancer. So both of those girls, I did circulating tumor cells to see what they were, and they were both had circulating tumor cells, and now I put them on a prevention protocol.
Okay,
and I'm following them.
Because we all really do have cancer.
We all have cancer, but we don't all have circulating tumor cells, though.
Okay,
so
we all have like stem cell kind of cancers?
Well, no, we just have cells that are being made and our immune system is attacking them.
Okay.
Right? And so if you have circulating tumor cells, that means a nest is already being formed.
And it's
and it's, remember, a millimeter in size.
So what about the, I've heard a lot about, I think it's an HCG with the urine, Navarro, Dr. Navarro
test. Navarro test. Yes, some of our patients do that too. It's not bad test at all. Also,
is that pretty accurate?
I would say it's very good indicator. Okay. Again, I personally do not use just one test because the body's very complex.
It's very dynamic.
You would never, never use just one test.
Yeah.
So the Navarro with a patient on their own for economic, it's also, it's very, very good.
It's pretty economically.
Yes.
It's a, okay.
Yes.
Wow.
So yes, if a patient doesn't want to spend a lot of money and they want to do some testing, yes.
And so what is that testing? The HCG levels in the urine?
It checks the HCG in the urine. So the cancer profile test that I mentioned earlier checks blood and urine.
Okay.
Okay, and so now I have had patients, just so you know, that have elevations but don't have cancer. So sometimes in menopausal patients, they will have elevations of HCG. So I tell people, you've got to put the panoramic view of the patient, and again, don't rely on one testing.
Yeah.
I confirm. Now, I also do lots of energy testing in my office.
Okay.
So we do something called the bioimmune survey. We take the acupuncture points on your fingers and toes that correspond to every organ in your body, and we measure the energy balance of every organ in your body and what will put it into balance, whatever's out of balance. Then we do something called the cancer cascade that was developed by Bill Curry, the gentleman who was the survivor of the osteosarcoma.
Oh, wow.
And it will tell me if you're in year one of cancer.
How does it do that?
Because the body doesn't lie. And he developed this thing called the cancer cascade. And in the beginning, you know, when I learned about it 18 years ago, I go, well, I don't know.
Yeah,
I got to make sure this is right. So I took a whole bunch of patients that I knew what they had.
Yeah.
And I measured them and it came up exactly what they had.
Wow.
Okay.
That's amazing.
So then now, because I've done so many patients, I put together this picture of the patient and make sure that I'm very, very accurate in what we're doing.
And also, people, it's a test is just a snapshot in time too, right? So,
right.
You know.
It is, but so that's why I'm saying, again, you wouldn't rely because this is someone's life. So you've got to make sure.
Yeah.
So if you do all those testing, but it's not that expensive to do these testing. It's not an expensive proposition. When you think about how much money you would spend if you got cancer, and not just what you spend, but everyone around you, the drain to yourself, your job, your family. If you think about the economic impact of everything,
it's huge.
Yeah.
If somebody wanted to come to your clinic, because we have listeners all over the world, but let's say someone's living in the United States, and let's say they live in New York or something, and they see this interview and they want to work with you, and they come to your clinic for an initial workup, I guess. Let's just say they're relatively healthy, you know, no real issues, but they just want to get healthier. Is it possible for them to come and do an initial diagnosis, or not diagnosis, but work up with you once, and then can they work remotely?
Yes, we do Skype
and
our phone consults in the beginning, because a lot of times we'll do it in the beginning and then have the patient come out. But a lot of patients, we treat patients.
So if they wanted to get like a yearly blood test and they got their first one from you physically in Irvine, California, but then they're in New York the rest of the time.
They can do that.
And so they can go get them there.
Absolutely.
And then you could go over the results with them.
Absolutely.
Okay. Wow.
Yeah.
That's cool.
Yeah.
Gosh, we live in awesome times, don't we?
I know. We
Isn't
do.
That amazing?
It is.
It's like with all of this internet access and social media, there's a lot of too much information, not all of it's accurate, and then a lot of propaganda and all this kind of stuff,
right.
But there's so much amazing technology and ability. I mean, all these testings that you're talking about, like, you know, 30, 40 years ago, they just didn't exist.
No, and that's what we want people to know, is that there are
so cool,
amazing opportunities to take care of yourself and things to know and the information and to back it all up too.
Yeah. Gosh, that's so cool. It's so cool that you're a medical doctor as well, because a lot of people only feel comfortable with medical doctors for, you know, because of, I guess, conditioning or something. But,
right.
You know, a lot of people you know, with my mom, the first thing she always says, is this person a medical doctor or are they just a regular doctor?
Right.
You know? So it's
yeah. So we're medically, we're medical doctors trained very conventionally.
All of you guys are medical doctors?
Yeah. And,
wow.
And so we all of us, I would say every single person in my practice had a tragic health problem.
In their life or in the life
in their life.
And
that's why they do what they do. Now, I do have a young Japanese girl who just started because she was just interested in integrative medicine.
So you didn't require a catastrophic.
Yeah, she didn't actually have a catastrophic situation.
But that's great.
But everyone comes from a serious health challenge. And that's why they do what they do.
That's so cool.
So it is.
So the name of your clinic is?
Center for New Medicine.
Center for New Medicine.
And Cancer Center for Healing.
So if they search your name in Google or do they search for Center for New Medicine?
Yeah, they can just search for my name, Dr. Okay. Connealy.
And they can find, wow, that is really cool. That's really cool that people can work remotely because, you know, obviously people can't travel all over the world.
Right. But in today's world, people do travel.
Yeah, that's true.
It's amazing how you can travel and how you can do Skype and how you can do phone and you can have someone guide you and them work with another doctor that maybe is another natural doctor too.
And I'm sure.
So, but everybody has their toolkit. They may not, the integrative functional medicine doctor may not quite have all the tools yet.
Yeah.
So we can instruct them, okay, look, you know, this would be great to do with that patient. So.
And your book, Cancer Revolution, is coming out
now this month, January 2017. So already available on Amazon.
It's already available.
Yes.
Okay. Uh-huh. Cool. So it hasn't officially launched, but it's available on Amazon and Barnes and Noble too.
Yes, Barnes and Noble.
It's funny. Uh-huh. I don't even go to Barnes and Noble. I just do the Amazon thing. Yeah. Do people still do that?
I know it'd be great though. It's another way to create community. Though.
Yeah. Yeah. That's so cool. Okay. The Cancer Revolution is the name of the book.
Right. That's correct.
Awesome. Thank you, Dr. Connealy.
Oh, thank you for having me.
Yeah, so great. Thank you so much.
All right.